The year is 2010. Katy Perry's at the top of the charts. Blockbuster is dying. And the US military is building one of the most powerful supercomputers in the world. Satellite imaging, real-time surveillance, AI research, this does it all. And the system powering it? Just under 2,000 PS3s. And if you don't believe me, look, I didn't either. This is like finding out the Gulf War was won using a fleet of Tamagotchis, you know, that all probably died of neglect. But I am getting ahead of myself, so let me back up a bit. To understand how a PS3 could run military surveillance, you kind of need to know a bit about Sony's weirdly complicated history with Linux and the tech hobbyists who love them. Now, the story doesn't start with the PS3 or even the PS2. It begins in 1994 with a man named Ken Kutaragi, father of the PlayStation. Now, Ken was basically Sony's internal rebel. I mean, he had to fight tooth and nail to even get the original PlayStation made, which is a crazy story in itself that I can't cover here. But when it finally launched in December of that year, he wasn't content with just selling consoles. He wanted people, not just developers, but regular people to build on them. And it took some time. But come June of 1996, Sony finally unveiled their strategy to make that happen. It was called the Net Yaroze. It was a sleek black version of the PS1 that you couldn't buy in stores. No games bundled, no flashy ads. It was just a dev kit, some manuals, and that quiet tear of debugging code at like 2 a.m.
Where's the any key?
Released in Japan, June of 1996, and later in Europe and North America in 97, it cost around $750, or $1,500 in today's money. Before that, you got a PlayStation that plugged into your PC and let you code your own games. Now, back in the 90s, if I asked for something that cost $750, I'd have it put in counseling. But the thing is, it wasn't for me or anyone else who just wanted to rock Final Fantasy after school. It was for those bedroom coders, the early tech heads, you know, the types who didn't just like playing games, but they also wanted to see how they worked. And the Net Yaroze, it was kind of like giving hobbyists the keys of the kingdom or like a spare key to the guest house, because it wasn't the official dev kit, but it got close enough to let you do some damage. And yeah, it wasn't some huge commercial success, but that wasn't the point. Sony didn't care if it flew off the shelves. They were banking on an idea that tinkerers in their bedrooms might one day become PlayStation's next big devs. Just like how early PC hobbyists went from messing around in BASIC to eventually making Doom. Even Sony's executive Phil Harrison reflected on it later, that they were one of the first companies to recognize this. And the Net Yaroze on the PS1 was crucial to the future of the games industry. And while the Net Yaroze didn't single-handedly birth the indie scene, it planted the seed. And more importantly, it showed that Sony, at one point, actually wanted users to mess with their hardware. And that spirit? Yeah, it stuck around. At least for a little while. Because then came the PS2. And Sony basically said, here's a full-blown Linux desktop on your console. Yeah, Linux. That Linux. It's the open source operating system held together by sheer willpower and dudes telling you how they use it. If someone uses Linux, they will tell you, unprompted, at every party. Even if that party isn't real and it's this YouTube video, I use Linux, welcome to my party. And weirdly enough, Sony was kind of the same way. In 2002, they dropped the PS2 Linux Kit. It was a hard drive, VGA adapter, USB keyboard and mouse, and a Red Hat-based distro. Everything you needed to turn your PS2 into a desktop computer. Compile code, browse files, write apps, even try your hand at building games. For a console that millions of parents simply knew as that DVD player that their child kept begging for. It was wild, and it actually caused a stir. At Linux World 2002, one article said that Sony's Linux Programmer's Kit for the PS2 created the loudest buzz at the show. That's right. In a room filled with IBM and Red Hat, Sony stole the show with a game console. For $199, you could tinker with hardware that commercial game makers normally spend thousands to access. And no, it wasn't meant for selling games to the masses. You couldn't press your own discs or get on store shelves. But Sony didn't lock the doors either. It was open, hackable, and surprisingly complete for a mainstream game machine. And don't forget, the PS2 sold over 160 million units. Even if only a sliver of owners tried Linux, that's still a mountain of curious minds booting into bash on what was supposed to be a toy. Try and imagine modern Sony doing this. You can't. The closest Sony gets to this level of creative support is Dreams, a game which I assume had the world's first negative marketing budget. But back then, they were just different. So different, in fact, that by 2003, multiple universities were running real courses on PS2 Linux development. The University of Alberta Dundee set up a full PS2 Linux lab backed directly by Sony execs. Over at Chepham Hallam University, they taught game dev and software skills using actual PS2 Linux consoles. And it didn't just stop with classrooms. That same year, the National Center for Supercomputing Apps built a Linux supercomputer using 70 PS2s. These were hand-wired, Ethernet-linked, and running real scientific calculations with open-source tools. Dan Reed, the director, called it a handmade supercomputer assembled by a creative group of researchers pushing the limits of their field, all built from the same hardware that millions were gaming on. This truly showed just how invested Sony was in this idea. Back in 2003, most big tech companies wouldn't touch Linux with a 10-foot pole. Meanwhile, Sony's out here putting it in living rooms and labs worldwide. But they weren't done there, not by a long shot. Sony's next move made it official. Running Linux on your game console was no longer just a very expensive fever dream, because come November of 2006, we finally saw the launch of the Sony PS3 and a feature Sony called OtherOS. Now, I don't need to sit here and retell you the entire PS3 story. It's been told 1,000 times before, and frankly, if you even found this video, you've seen 100 or 200 of them already. But I am here to tell you about a little known feature that solidified Sony's love for Linux. A feature that let both hobbyists and the military take full advantage of the hardware. And a feature that was quietly removed after a hacker got a little too good with the software. But more on that soon. So what even is OtherOS? Well, OtherOS was literally a one-click install of Linux directly onto the PS3. All you had to do was plug in a USB with whatever Linux distro you wanted, add a mouse and keyboard, and you were good to go. So, what could you actually do with the setup? Well, pretty much everything you'd expect from like a mid-2000s desktop. Just on a console so large that it basically came pre-installed with back pain. You could code, run servers, browse the web at blistering 2006 speeds, and, more impressively, tap directly into the PS3 cell architecture. A notoriously weird but powerful chip with multiple parallel cores that loved crunching numbers. Developers who took the time to wrangle it found out it could outperform many CPUs of the day, not in gaming, but in raw compute tasks like simulations, image processing, and even neural nets. And this wasn't just some fringe hobby. Just like with the PS2 before, universities were teaching with it. North Carolina State built an 8 PS3 Linux cluster to teach parallel programming. UMass Dartmouth Physics Lab ran gravitational wave simulations on a PS3 grid, simulating black holes on a budget, and even getting published for it. Researchers got serious with it. Those same PS3 clusters were pushing out data that once required supercomputers, thanks to the cell's vector performance. It's shocking just how capable this thing was for the day. And then there was the US military. In 2010, the Air Force Research Lab built the Condor Cluster, 1,760 PS3s hand-wired together running Yellow Dog and MPI. It processed radar data, satellite imagery, and even ran AI models for real-time analysis. At its peak, it cranked out 500 teraflops, making it one of the top 40 fastest supercomputers in the world, all at a fraction of the cost and power draw of traditional setups. Built from game consoles, with the Spider-Man font on the box. Like, it sounds ridiculous, but this was serious defense infrastructure, all running on a console that had that one Metal Gear Solid cutscene that straight up wouldn't end. Like, why is this an hour and 10 minutes? I digress. What about the tinkerers at home? Well, as with all new or obscure hardware, they ported Doom to it. And it also ran ports of Quake, different emulators, media servers. You could even spin up your own little dev environment. So it wasn't just a gimmick. OtherOS made the PS3 a legit low-cost workstation. It was weird, powerful, and pretty open. And in hindsight, maybe too open for Sony's comfort. Especially after one George Hotz got a little too good with the software. You might know him as Geohot, the guy who jailbroke the iPhone at 17. Well, a couple years later, he turned his attention to the PS3. To understand what he pulled off, you need to know how OtherOS actually worked under the hood. You see, Sony didn't just let you install Linux outright. They built the console with a hypervisor. It was a layer of software that sat between Linux and the PS3's actual hardware. Think of it like a bouncer at a club. Linux could come in, but it wasn't allowed in the VIP section. No direct access to the GPU or certain chunks of RAM. So yeah, you got Linux, but you sort of got the diet version. You can think of it like the Coke Zero of Coca-Cola, or the water of Mountain Dew, because let's be honest, no one drinks Diet Mountain Dew. It was sandboxed, dual booted, and was limited intentionally, because Sony wanted to keep people from getting full control of the console, until Geohot got a hold of it. In 2010, he cracked the hypervisor and posted custom tools online that let users bypass all restrictions. Suddenly, you could access the GPU, full RAM, everything. The PS3 went from being a closed ecosystem to a wide open dev playground overnight. This was big. It was like giving the public root access to the entire PlayStation OS. And Sony? Well, they freaked out. You see, they'd spent years promising that OtherOS wasn't going anywhere. Keep in mind, this wasn't some feature buried away, never to be spoken of like every teenager's 2007 Xbox messages. It was an advertised feature, pitched to scientists, hobbyists, and universities as a legit reason to choose the PS3. Plenty of people bought the PS3 because it was a good deal. They could turn it into a desktop and then get their ass kicked in Call of Duty later on it. But to Sony, this neat hobbyist-focused feature suddenly became the boogeyman. They started thinking about their intellectual property, the potential for piracy, and their shareholders. So they pulled the plug. On April 1st, 2010, a firmware update, version 3.21, quietly killed OtherOS. They gave people 2 days' notice. And if you didn't update, you lost access to both the PSN and also Blu-ray playback. They made people choose between Linux and watching literally any movie in 480p. I'm not going back, man. DVD resolution looks like a movie filmed through a tube of toothpaste, regardless. That date will live on as the end of Sony's great Linux experiment. But this isn't where the story ends. Because in America, when someone doesn't get what they pay for, they sue. But first, what happened to Hotz? Surely, Sony went after him immediately, right? Well, in early 2011, Sony filed a lawsuit against George Hotz for posting tools that cracked the PS3 hypervisor. They accused him of copyright infringement, DMCA violations, the whole arsenal. Not because he pirated games, but because his tools could somehow downstream allow others to do so. And that's what this is really about. Not Linux, not root access, but control. Sony had sold a console marketed to gamers, scientists, and tinkers. And now one of those tinkers figured out how to unlock its full potential. To Sony, that meant risk. Piracy, homebrew, lost profits. To the community, it meant freedom. And that clash, freedom versus control, exploded. The lawsuit kicked off a huge public backlash. It wasn't just techies and modders defending Hotz. Even people who never touched Linux saw the bigger issue. If you buy hardware, should you be allowed to do whatever you want with it? And then Anonymous got involved. They launched Operation Sony, a wave of DDoS attacks protesting the lawsuit. Their goal? Raise awareness. What followed, though, was on a completely different scale. On April 20th, 2011, PlayStation Network went down. For 23 days, users couldn't log in, play online, or access digital purchases. Sony eventually admitted it wasn't just maintenance. It was a full-blown breach. 77 million accounts compromised. Names, passwords, possibly credit card data. Inside of Sony's servers, their investigators claimed that they found a file that said Anonymous and We Are Legion. But Anonymous denied any involvement, insisting they're protesting, not stealing, and certainly wouldn't try to actively harm PSN users themselves. To this day, no one knows for sure who did it. Maybe it was a rogue actor. Maybe someone used the chaos as cover. But what we know is this. Sony lost the narrative. They'd started with a promise of openness and Linux support, but the moment users unlocked that potential, Sony panicked and slammed the door shut. The legal battle with Hotz was eventually settled. He agreed to stop tinkering with the PS3, and Sony dropped the case. But the damage was done. Security experts called out Sony's poor response, and the courts were left with a messy question that's still being debated today. When you buy a device, a console, a phone, a car, or even a game, do you own it? Or are you simply renting it, buried under text that is so long it makes the Kingdom Hearts timeline look sane? And if you're thinking, wait, didn't you mention they got sued over this? Yeah, they did. A class action lawsuit was filed on behalf of PS3 owners who lost the feature they were literally promised. Sony fought it for years. Appeals, rejections, delays, and finally in 2016, they agreed to settle. The payout? $55 if you could actually prove you used OtherOS, and you got about 10 bucks if you just said you cared. Yeah, 10 bucks. You can't even buy a Taco Bell combo that won't turn on you in 20 minutes for that much for a feature that was pitched as a legit reason to buy the console, publicly advertised and then yanked away in a 2-day window. The cash started to hit bank accounts around 2017, and by that time, most people had either moved on or forgot it ever happened. But the questions it raised, those never went away. What does it actually mean to own something? Your console, your game, your software. If you bought the hardware, but the company controls the software, do you really own anything at all? Anyway, that's the story. A strange, powerful little experiment that Sony ran, then quietly buried. Not many people even know it existed, but now you do. And if you found this interesting, share it with someone else. Who knows? Maybe Sony will bring it back someday, just for old time's sake. And until next time, thanks for watching. Bye.